Hello.
Good morning, everyone. It's nice to meet all of you. I'm Francis. I'm from Kutipo Hospital, same hospital as the Chat. And we use ultrasound fairly often, especially in this context of EFAS, which I'm sure you are familiar with, because I'm sure you have done it often enough. Now, EFAS came from the word fast, actually. FAST was first described by a surgeon. Her name is Grace Wazinski. She did several papers before that, but finally in 1998, she actually put a paper to say that it's possible to use this test to identify certain cases. And the definition of FAST, the focus assessment of sonography for trauma, really focused on a few things. It's a survey of the pericardial region for hemopericardium, the right and left upper quadrant and pelvis for free fluid, which is hemoperitoneum, in patients with trunk injuries. So that's what FAST, the basis of FAST, is all about. And then FAST combining with the assessment of pneumothorax. So you may be wondering why I put this equine practice. Because the first time pneumothorax was described using ultrasound was by a vet in that year, 1986. It's only the next year, 1987, that it was described in a human. So through that, of course, there are a lot of development about how to talk about different types of ultrasound and pneumothorax. But later on, it was Kirkpatrick that integrated the two things and said that, okay, we are using FAST to assess trauma. There's a potential use of ultrasound to actually diagnose pneumothorax, which is also a problem we are worried about in trauma. So why don't we combine it? And there, he called the EFAST, the extended FAST examination. Now, EFAST principle. So EFAST focuses on very, very basic things. Where do we scan? We know that air rises, so the scanning position will be the anterior surface of the lung. Another scanning position, which is also talked about in FAST, is of course assessing the pericardium for hemopericardium through a sub-xiphoid position. And of course, fluid sinks. And fluid sinks, you want to look for spaces where fluid will collect or the blood will collect. So you look at the the pleural spaces for hemothorax. This part is actually not exactly talked about in the EFAST paper, but over time, people start to recognize, yeah, we can also look at using a FAST technique to look at hemothorax. And of course, the subdiaphragmatic space, not to forget, because blood will collect there, the Morrison's pouch, and the infrarenal pole, where fluid can also collect in one area. And of course, this is the pouch of Douglas in a female. Of course, in a male, there is a rectal vesicle pouch. And of course, on the other side, same thing, is a pleural space for fluid, subdiaphragmatic space, splenorenal space, the inferior pole of the kidney, as well as that part as well. Right, so therefore, in FAST, it's very straightforward. There are actually six areas. You can actually do it in any sequence, but I think more efficient is to do it this way. You scan starting from the lung, the anterior part, then move your probe to the side where you scan the lower part of the lung, as well as the Morrison's area, which is what this whole thing is called right upper quadrant. Then you proceed to the other side as a comparison, left upper anterior, and then the left upper quadrant, which is again the lower part of the lung together with the splenorenal space. Then you want to do this, the sub-xiphoid view, finally ending with the pelvic view or the suprapelvic view. Okay? So it's EFAST. So this is the flow. Step one, right anterior, right quadrant, upper quadrant, then left anterior, then left upper quadrant, sub-xiphoid and pelvic, right? So let us look at what we should see. So this is a scan of a normal person. What do you see? Lung sliding, right? That's precisely what we want to look for. Pneumothorax, right? So in this case, there's no pneumothorax in a trauma patient. Now, then we move on the probe to the right lower lung field, which is right upper quadrant, but looking at the lung base. What are we seeing here? What am I trying to demonstrate in this video? What sign is this? Curtain sign, that's right. It is because the organs are protected by the diaphragm, and the diaphragm are protected by the rib cage. Therefore, the lung always overlap part of the intra-abdominal space. So whenever the person breathes in, the lung will always come into the picture. And this movement of the lung over here is like someone drawing a curtain, closing a curtain. And you can never see this part of the diaphragm. You should never see this part of the diaphragm. If you see this part of the diaphragm, that means either the lung is pushed away or something is happening to that part of the lung that allows you to see the diaphragm. So this is curtain sign that we're looking for. So the next area is Morrison's pouch, and what do you see? This is the space between the liver and the kidney. This is what I call a potential space. There is a space there, but most of the time it's nothing but just a bit of fat, right, and part of the kidney capsule. There should not be anything in between. This is a Morrison's space. This scan is not not ideal because I'm not seeing the inferior part of the kidney. Here it is obscured by bowel gas casting a shadow here. So therefore, the scanning is not just a static thing. You have to actually adjust, move around, and look at other planes to make sure that you're not missing a small pocket of fluid. Again, the left side, same thing, lung. And the left upper quadrant, left lung bay, same thing. Curtain sign, but overlooking the spleen. So you know when you scan the lung bases, always look for the organs to guide you where you're looking at. Because if you move too far, you may be looking at a very funny shadow that's actually the intra-abdominal content that may confuse you. Splenorenal space, okay? This scan shows a better splenorenal area, but it can show the inferior pole quite clearly, right? And it's no fluid, no collection over there. Subxiphoid. Subxiphoid is applied with a probe flat onto the abdomen, scanning through the liver, because the liver is good, provide a good acoustic window to enable you to see the heart, right ventricle, right atrium, left ventricle, left atrium, to look for pericardial effusion or hemopericardium in the context of trauma. Right. Sometimes if the abdomen is very big and gassy, you have to shift your probe further to the patient's right in order to catch the liver window. I mean, if in my practice, if all else fails, I'll put this probe directly onto the chest itself. Okay? But that's not describing FAST. FAST talks about the subxiphoid view. Okay, so this is transverse view. You see a distended bladder, and there should not be fluid out there. Longitudinal view, right? Bladder. This is a male patient. They should not see fluid around here. These are bowel gas. Right, so it tells you that in order for this view to be successful, your bladder must be distended. If your bladder is collapsed, then all the bowel gas will come in. You will not be able to appreciate any fluid that collects there. So it becomes a problem. This is similar in a lady. Right, so this is a bladder, uterus, and then you look for free fluid underneath the pouch of Douglas, which in this case is of course normal. Okay, so now we know all the different levels, what are we focusing on? The right anterior lung field, what we look for is pneumothorax, but pulmonary contusion can also be seen very early in trauma. And this is not described in our papers, but we know from our practice we can actually diagnose this very early in the trauma case. Right upper quadrant is for hemothorax, free fluid abdomen, and so forth, left. And the left upper quadrant, also free fluid hemothorax, pericardial effusion, and free fluid pelvis. Okay? Let's look at pathology. This is a right lung, right anterior lung. Any problem with this? Lung sliding present, no B lines. Okay, this is a normal slide actually. Another patient. What do we see? Lung sliding present? Yes. So there's no pneumothorax. Okay, and also there's something else that tells you there's no pneumothorax. What is that? B lines. That's right. B lines must start from a varietal pleural, that means the lung is in contact. But this B line, is it a normal or abnormal B line? It's abnormal, right? You know why? Because it's very thick and there are more than three B lines in the intercostal space. So in this patient probably was previously healthy, got into some sort of injury. B lines help to diagnose pulmonary contusion. That means it's bleeding inside the lung, causing the interstitial to be thickened. That's why you get this pulmonary contusion. Okay? Right lung base, what do you see? What is missing here? What sign is gone? Curtain sign, right. Because the lung has been pushed all the way to one corner, the lung is no longer able to expand. And like I tell you before, you should not see this part of the diaphragm, and now you're seeing it. So there is a hemothorax. There's a pleural effusion, so in trauma, it's hemothorax. Also, there's a suggestion of fluid here in the subdiaphragmatic space. Of course, you must do more thorax scanning to decide on this. Morrison's pouch. Any problem here? Yes, there's a sliver of a dark band here, right? Not sure whether it's a vascular structure inside the liver, but in this space, you have to examine carefully. For this patient, it is hemoperitoneum. It's actually blood in the Morrison's pouch. These are probably some of the fat or some of the tissues inside the abdomen, but this is really the Morrison's pouch being separated by fluid. Another patient. Okay? Again, this is abnormal. This is a positive FAS. Morrison's pouch is still something. Sometimes, of course, there are false positive, like a vessel structure or there's some other the capsular structure can give you this. So examine more thoroughly to decide. This one is very obvious, right? This is a patient, they came in after he was struck on the side by during a construction work, and he actually had a ruptured kidney. Of course, demonstrated on CT scan, but here you can see fluid, a free fluid with some debris here. It could be some of the tissular debris. Okay, it could be air. Air also looks like that if it's suspended inside a fluid condition. What do you see here? Yes, there's no lungs by there. What you're seeing is just the chest wall trying to move when a patient tries to breathe. But there's hardly any activity here. This is pneumothorax. Okay? Previously healthy patient suffer a trauma and then on the chest and then no lungs are there, it's the pneumothorax. Any problem with this one? Right, you can see a little bit of curtain sign, right? Yeah, but this curtain sign shows that the lung is expanded. Right, it's actually touching the side, it's expanded. There's no fluid pushing there, but there's something wrong. The spleen seems to be separated a little bit of distance from here, right? There's actually a subdiaphragmatic collection of fluid in this patient. In intra-abdominal trauma, on this side, on the left side, because of the way the spinocolic ligament and the spinogastric ligament are oriented, very often the fluid flows to the subdiaphragmatic space first before they go to the splenorenal space. So you may not see any fluid here, but that's the first place you collect. So don't forget to carefully look at this part of the left upper quadrant. Another patient. Okay. Another patient suffered a road traffic accident. He has both. There's number one, there's no curtain sign, right? Because the lung is here. It's been pushed to one side. So you have hemothorax. But then he has something else. There's hemoperitoneum as well. Right, this spleen is actually surrounded by fluid, it's a diaphragm. So he has both hemothorax and hemoperitoneum. This is spleen. I'm scanning further down in another patient. This is the, can't really see the spleen, but there's some fluid here. You can see fluid here. Inferior pore of the inferior pore of the kidney. You can see fluid collection here. So that's a reminder they must scan thoroughly. Sometimes you don't see fluid in one place, but you must go on to see any collected fluid somewhere else. Subxiphoid, okay, your hemopericardium. And this is a bad effect. It's causing a tamponade. You can see how the wall is collapsed and being squeezed to one side. This can hardly actually expand. So this is a pericardial effusion with a tamponade effect. Converse view of this patient. The standard bladder showing a collection of fluid here. Right. This is very important that you must scan thoroughly because sometimes you do have a patient that suffer abdominal trauma but they walk into a clinic. So when they lie down for you to scan, the upper part may be negative but the fluid is collected down there. Right. So remember to be thorough in your scanning. Right. Another patient, what do you see? Is there free fluid? This is a male patient, okay? What shadow is this? What is this? That's right, this is a pubic bone, the pubic symphysis, right? And this is a distended bladder, this is a bowel. There's no free fluid. Okay, in this case, there's no free fluid. But all these are blood clots. This patient had a lower abdominal trauma, and then he suffered from hematuria, and what we saw in the scan is blood clot, but there's no free fluid outside. Okay, so FAST is a very useful examination because it can be quickly done by all of us, and pneumothorax can be ruled out in a few seconds, less than 1 minute. And in some studies, it shows that the average time required to do a complete examination is only 2 to 3 minutes, very, very quick. So FAST is a very useful technique. Okay? But understand this very important principle. Negative FAST doesn't mean there's no injury. Because FAST is not an accurate predictor of intra-abdominal injury. There are lots of papers written about this, and this paper is quite recent that I don't agree with the conclusion in this paper because they condemn and say that FAST is not good, you must proceed to CT scan. But the lesson to be learned from this paper is really that a negative FAST doesn't mean there's no injury. Because in their paper, a false negative, a negative FAST ended up with a 28 pathology in this number of patients. So actually, it is quite significant. So FAST is not accuracy, but FAST is designed to do one thing. Look for free fluid to help you decide whether there's an injury. That's how it's being used. Okay? But FAST is very good for predicting laparotomy, especially in a hypotensive patient. You see, hypotensive patient, if you have small amount of fluid, 70% of patients actually underwent a laparotomy in this study of about over 5,000 patients. They singled out those that have been done. And out of this, there's about 43 patients that have small amount of free fluid and a therapeutic laparotomy, that means they go into do an operation and they actually found something that they must treat. It's called therapeutic laparotomy. It's quite high. And even in a patient that's a normotensive, the predictive value may not be that good, but still, many patients do, significant proportion of patients do undergo a very therapeutic laparotomy. So positive FAST is very good to predict the need for laparotomy, right? But negative FAST means that you have to be very careful about saying, oh, this fellow is okay. So integrating FAST and trauma, this is a guide that we should actually work with our surgeon, our surgical colleague to say that, you know, when we do a FAST, if it's an unstable patient and it's a positive FAST, really you should not be actually thinking too much about delaying time and go for a definitive study, you should go to OR as a patient hypertensive. For a stable patient, it is alright that you have time when the scanning is done. So this has to be integrated in your trauma protocol in the hospital. Now, what's the problem with eFAST scanning? Right, number one, like what I said earlier, you have too much belief in the power of doing ultrasound study and getting a positive result, negative result, and you argue with the surgeon that you don't need a scan. You shouldn't be over-reliant on it. Organ injury are not visible because that's not the idea of FAST. You look for fluid, not organ, actually. Patient can sometimes give you a lot of problems in scanning. And there are a lot of false positives. For example, a patient that's chronic renal failure, they come with ascites, and they have their trauma, it's hard to predict. And fats and other organs can cause problems. And remember, when you have a negative FAST in trauma, right, and you have a chance, always repeat it, because the first one may be negative, but the next one may be positive. Then omission of steps, you don't do a thorough one, and you're not thorough in looking at all the signs that I told you. So these are the things that you should remember when you're doing eFAST. Thank you.